Hello, everybody. This is Michael Busby. I call myself the Constant Geographer on my YouTube Constant Geography channel. Thank you for watching my college writing tips. I think these tips are important because my intent on these writing tips is to make us better writers, better thinkers, better critical thinkers. And I also kind of want to open the curtain a little bit and reveal sort of what faculty and professional staff, people involved in education, are thinking about when they're going through and evaluating your writing assignments. I don't think anything should be a mystery when it comes to education. I think everybody needs to know, you know, how they're being evaluated, why they're being evaluated. But in a larger scheme of things, I think the overall arching sense here is we're trying to improve society, right? That's the whole idea behind becoming educated. Yes, your personal goal may be to get a college education because you know you're going to make more money and it's going to improve your chances for promotion. And so, you know, you have some personal incentive to do this. But overall, you know, what's going to happen is as you become more educated and you make more money and you have more influence on society, I'm hoping that spills over into a positive benefit for society, and then society becomes better. And so an educated society is a better society. It means we can address issues better, hopefully in a more logical and consistent manner, more civil manner, and it kind of works against this this kind of anti-education, anti-intellectual, themes that are kind of penetrating society these days. That I find somewhat disturbing because there's not a whole lot of critical thinking that's going on, particularly within our political realm. And I don't want to deviate too much off the path that I've set up for me this morning to talk about. But writing is certainly a very important part of this because with writing, you know, one of the goals of writing is you might want to be trying to convince somebody of something. Like you want them to buy your product, or you want them to invest in your startup, and you've got to write a pitch plan. Well, your business pitch is going to have to be a solid, tight piece of writing that you're going to need to put out there and get your point across, because you may only have 15 or 20 minutes in order to do this, maybe 30, depending on the environment and such. So you want to put your best foot forward. You want to make sure that this writing is solid, that it's full of good examples, that I get your point across. And so that's my ultimate goal with these writing tips. I know I call them college writing tips, but they're pretty good tips for just writing in general. This one is called Never List. Now, there's some caveats that I could throw in there because there are some exceptions. Those exceptions usually go along the lines of list three reasons. Okay, so if the instructions of an assignment say to list, or if the bullets are already there on the paper, or the numbers are already there and it's self-evident that you're going to list something, then, you know, you're following the instructions. So basically what I'm talking about here in terms of no listing is if you're given an essay question and the essay question says, describe and discuss. Well, if you list, in my classes you get a zero. I don't care if your content, if the content of those lists, if your bullet points, your enumerated list elements are correct, you haven't followed the directions, and so you're going to get a zero in my class for doing that. What I tell students to do is stop doing that. You know, if you want to make a list, do it on the back of the exam, make your enumerated list, get them in a logically consistent order, and then use that list to write your paragraph. Because I don't want to see a list, because I want you to follow the directions. There's lots of things in society where you have to follow directions. You've got to follow directions for the IRS. If you do any kind of follow any kind of bureaucracy with any kind of government agency, you're going to have to follow the directions. And if you don't follow the directions, you know, either your application is going to be delayed or your application is going to end up in the trash. So, you know, one of my other goals for these videos is to coach you on, you know, following the directions and doing those things which are expected of you so that you can not have to worry about, you know, these incidental details holding you back. And so I'm coaching you and helping you put good practices into practice, good techniques into practice perhaps, so that you can be successful later on. So when I say never list, I don't know what's happened. I think somewhere between somewhere in the grades of 9 through 12, I suspect the teachers are to blame. I'm sorry if you're an educator and you're following me on this, but if you're giving students homework assignments, you tell them to describe or discuss, and they come back with you with a list or sentence fragments, you know, with a hyphen or numbers or little circles, and you say, okay, this is great. It's not great because they haven't followed your directions, and then when they get to college, you're not encouraging them to follow good examples. And so at that point, they should be handed back their assignment and say, I didn't ask you for bullet points or numbers or sentence fragments. I asked you to tell me to use your words, in other words, to write sentences and describe or discuss this topic for me. When you do that, you are helping them. You're not helping them by being nice. The vast majority of my students are education majors. I would say it used to be about 80%. I used to keep statistics because I would ask everybody what their major or minor was, and I would keep statistics. Now I think it's more like 50%. I think we're down to about 50%, maybe a little bit less, I'm not sure, but I get a lot of middle school educators in my classes, for example, and I personally have had both current and former education students admit to cheating and plagiarism, which really bothers me because not only is it unethical, but you're an educator who is engaged in conduct which you will not tolerate and should not be tolerated. You need to set a better standard for that. Being caught in unethical behavior as a student, education student, should be immediate grounds for removal from a program. If you are caught plagiarizing and as a student who wants to be an educator, you should be done. Maybe a second chance. But really, don't do it. Reality slaps the students on the hands and at worst tells them not to do it again. But don't do what again? Don't get caught. That just tells me that I need to go back and figure out a better way of doing this, of cheating. So don't cheat. In an earlier post, I blamed my peers, people my age, who love the social atmosphere of high school, yet fought against the intellectual expansion of those 4 years were supposed to offer. My peers then have engaged in the evisceration of rules and policies, from anything from corporal punishment, the reduction or banning of homework, or to the dilution of assessment criteria. You know, one of the jokes that I sort of tell my classes once in a while is, you know, when I was in elementary school, going back in the 70s, if a student in my elementary school got SWATs, the entire school knew it, and it put an element of fear into everyone in that school. Some might say it was respect because the guys giving the SWATs were the two male teachers in the school, and nobody wanted to be in that position, so everybody behaved, right? Everybody knew that if you got out of line, you were probably going to get a SWAT by one of the sixth grade male teachers, and so you really try not to do that. And so it only took one or two examples of school year, and then you really didn't have too much in the way of behavioral problems. Now we've become too much of a, in my opinion, of a kind of a touchy-feely society, and we tell, you know, Jimmy or Johnny, you know, we can't do that, and the problem doesn't really go away because they don't really understand the problem. We've got a couple schools in my region that if you're a senior, you don't do homework. If you're a senior in high school, you're excused from doing homework. I feel that that's a bad idea because that's when you should be getting the coaching that you need to help you engage in college. You don't need to be taking time off. This is when you should be saying, this is what college life is like. This is what college writing is like. This is what you're going to be expected to know. This is how you're going to be expected to behave. You know, we need to put these elements into practice because these are important things. It's a terrible idea to take away the learning experience that certain homework assignments should have for a senior in high school. The other thing is the dilution of assessment criteria, and this goes to my point really is the listing things. a student that the student did not follow directions is irrelevant, or their writing is full of misspellings, comma splicing, and is borderline phonetic in structure. Is their content appropriate for the topic? And so a lot of this stuff goes to, well, I don't care if they misspelled. I don't care if they didn't use grammar. I don't care if it was a complete run-on sentence for the next 6 or 7 lines. I literally have had students tell me that I don't use punctuation because I don't speak using punctuation. Yes, you do. When you pause, that's a comma. If you pause longer, that could be a semicolon. It could be a period. If you give a list of things, there's an implied colon in there. You know, there's all sorts of problems with that statement. If you are not evaluating your student's work, not only on its content, and whether it's, you know, fits in with the larger context, the problem then becomes you're letting this person get by with a whole litany of problems that are not going to pay off for them when they reach college or a university environment. So you really need to do a better job of making sure that those students are following instructions. So it doesn't matter if you're in if you're a middle school educator or a high school educator, or maybe you're teaching a community college class in the evening. You really need to be focused on what is your true mission here. Your true mission is to coach these, you know, soon to be adults or young adults to be successful. And that's my point with these videos. I know sometimes I sound harsh, and my students tell me I sound harsh. But the reality is that's why I'm here. That's why football coaches are harsh and they yell and scream, and baseball coaches are harsh and yell and scream, and basketball coaches are harsh and yell and scream, because they're trying to get a level of ability out of someone who they know has that ability, right? And that's what my goal is with these videos, is I know the majority of people out there have the ability, and you know, I'm letting you know that it is possible for you to expose yourself to this. And to get that ability out of yourself with maybe an extra 15 or 20 minutes, really. I mean, some of these things don't take much more than maybe an extra 15 to 20 minutes of time. I'll be the first one to admit, I enjoy a bit of subversion once in a while. I really appreciate out-of-the-box thinking, but I don't just want out-of-the-box thinking with these things. I want the box really destroyed. The rules of coherent communication still need to be followed. Faithful communication with 100% fidelity, with no signal loss, with a maximum signal to noise ratio, can really only be maintained if communication rules are adhered to. So if you encourage somebody, you know, just write and don't put any punctuation in it, you know, that's fine for a journal, but then later you have to tell them that this is what we have to do. We have to use grammar and punctuation because we've got to communicate with 7 billion people in the world. And those 7 billion people are going to expect punctuation because that's how the fidelity of the message is maintained. So you really have to follow rules for validating spelling, validating grammar, and validating punctuation. You know, one of the things that, you know, here's a phrase that I'll read you. Discuss HIV/AIDS infection rates in sub-Saharan Africa. Provide at least 5 reasons why rates continue to remain high in some countries. And here's an example of a response that I would get from a student. They would give me a numbered list. That's wrong. You're going to get a 0 because I say discuss. You know, I didn't say enumerate. I didn't say list. I said discuss. But here's what I have seen, and this is what faculty hate to see. So, and if you want to follow along, you can look at my Constant Geography blog. So, number one, they'll say education. Number two, they'll say the government. Number three, they'll say sexual education. Number four is war. Number five is conflict. That's not a discussion. That's not even a good list because I don't know what any of those mean. What do you mean by education being a reason why rates continue to remain high? I don't understand what that means. You haven't given me any evidence. You haven't given me any support, any kind of factual information that explains what part education plays. Do you mean sex education? Do you mean education in general? Do you mean education about health? I don't know. I have to guess. And you never want to put the faculty in a position to guess, because the faculty will always guess wrong, right? That's what we're supposed to do, is guess wrong. Don't put us in a position to guess wrong. Tell us what you mean. That's what your obligation is to do. I don't know what government means. Does government mean they don't spend enough money, they spend too much money, they don't spend it in the right place, the governments are corrupt, the governments are theocracies and they don't believe in sex education. What do you mean by that? War and conflict, those are almost the same things, right? War can be conflict, but does conflict mean social conflict? Are there different religious groups that have different ideologies that are preventing the you know, the implementation and the introduction of, STD education? I don't know what this means. So you never want to write like this. This is, I know, and when I was in high school, I would see my peers and they would write like this, and for some reason that would be okay. It's not okay. So if you're an educator watching these videos, these kind of answers they're meaningless, really. You don't want to let your students get outside your classroom thinking that these types of answers are fine. An enumerated list is not a discussion. It's not even descriptive. While the instructions ask for 5 reasons, I really only count 4 because war and conflict are essentially the same thing, unless you can figure out a way of separating those two. At least with number 1 and number 3, there's a slight difference that's kind of implied, but again, we could collapse these down into 3, really, because there could be, I don't know what you mean by education and sex education. Maybe you mean the same thing. If I were in a bad mood, which happens once in a while because, faculty don't come out of these petri dishes. We're not grown in some secret lab in Nevada somewhere. We're people that have all been through stuff. And so, maybe we've had a bad day and we read your writing and you're like, man, this is garbage. And you're not going to get any points for this. And in fact, I wouldn't give any points for this because it's an enumerated list and I asked for discussion. The reality is, bad mood or not, the list above earns a 0 in my book simply because the students didn't follow the directions. Any response, which is anything other than a paragraph of prose, a response should really earn a 0. The real world has rules. We may not like those rules, we may not have voted for those rules, but the reality is that there's a structure. The business world has real expectations for their employees. Schools, teachers, faculty who do allow their students to skate by thinking the above response is acceptable are really derelict. And their students are useless to college's students and really business, because you really haven't carried forward what, you're not implementing the stuff that industry and commerce, commercial sector and the business sector really wants to see. And so while you might be accepted as being nice and easy and friendly, you're not really helping people. Students who find the above acceptable need to check themselves. Thinking you are getting by easy is really a fool's notion. You've only really cheated yourself. You've paid money to this coach who's supposed to push you and make you better, and really they've just, given you a grade and you haven't improved at all. So you really have to ask yourself, am I the type of personality that really wants to just kind of skate by and do this? And if you are, well, I guess that's fine. It goes back to what I said in a previous video, is like, you're the one in control of yourself. But I really hope that, that in the university education is really supposedly about, improving the level of not just knowledge inside your head, but your approach to educating yourself and your approach to society in general. So, if you think that these things are good ideas, they're technically not, but you've cheated yourself, and in reality, you're sort of cheating society as well, too. So, I really would have you examine the real rationale for those actions. So, I appreciate you watching these college video tips. If anybody wants any more tips or questions, please email me or leave a comment on my Constant Geography YouTube channel. I've mentioned my blog here a few times, constantgeography.com. You're welcome to send me an email or comment on those. Those are moderated as well, too, to prevent, there's nonsense out there. It seems like there's more nonsense than critical thinkers, which is really sort of disturbing. But I hope these videos work for you, and thank you for watching.